Good evening, everyone, and welcome to A Time with the SL. Thank God for a beautiful Monday. Our loving God, who is in heaven, we thank you for allowing us to meet as a group this evening to study your word. Father, I want to thank you for the opportunity that we have as we open the word. This word speaks of you, and it speaks of the plan that you have for each and everyone's life. Let's get this music a bit lower. We ask that the Holy Spirit would take so that we can learn and know your will. Father, thank you. We ask that you be with us until the very end. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Today, the word we are looking at is the legacy of Lois. The legacy of Lois. And we begin our countdown to Mothering Sunday. Yay, Mothering Sunday. It actually is not Mother's Day as we know it. Mother's Day as we know it is in May. But we celebrate Mothering Sunday on the 27th of March. We're taking our text from 2 Timothy 1:1-5. So in the next 4 days, we're going to be looking at different passages of scripture that focus on the impact that mothers can have in the lives of their children. I don't know who here has heard of Lois. Who has heard of Lois? She's not one of the more popular females in the Bible because she's only mentioned once, just once, in the Word of God. She's mentioned just once. The Bible doesn't really say that much about her. Most of us. She may go unnoticed by most of us. But if you have spent any time in the New Testament, you may not know who Lois is, but you certainly will know who her grandson is. Her grandson, you would have heard of her grandson, Timothy. Timothy was Lois's or is Lois's grandson. And I read 2 Timothy 1:1-5. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, according to the promise of life, which is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my dearly beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve without ceasing. I have remembrance of thee in my prayers day and night, greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. Amen. Amen. I hope the connection is okay. Do we have a good connection? So I ask you this evening, what is it? What did Paul thank God for? What came to Paul's mind when he thought of Timothy? What came to Paul's mind when he thought of Timothy? What was it that filled Paul with joy when he thought of Timothy? When he called in Timothy. And what is unfeigned faith? Sincere or genuine? This passage tells us that Timothy had a kind of sincere faith. Genuine faith, just like his mother Eunice had, and just like his grandmother Lois also had. There was clearly a faith transfer from one generation to another. But how did this happen? What was the key? What was the key to this transfer? How did this happen? How was faith able to transfer from grandmother to daughter? And then to grandson. Let's look at 2 Timothy 3:14-15. But continue thou in the thing assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learnt them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Jesus Christ. So we ask ourselves this evening, what was it that impacted Lois? What was it? What was it? The Bible tells us it was his mother. It was his mother. Just as his grandmother invested the Holy Scriptures into his life also, she must have also invested them into her daughter's life. What does the Bible tell us about faith? Let's turn our Bibles to Romans 10:17. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Let's look at the word of God increased, and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly, and a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. Beloved, in everything we do, the word of God is the critical element. You may have someone that is talking to you that is so eloquent. Word of God, it is only human. It is a human emotion that is at work, that is at play. The word of God is the critical element that is necessary for people to learn of Christ, that is necessary for people to repent of their sins, and is necessary for people to come to faith. Unfeigned faith is sincere and it is genuine. That is why they say, by their fruit you will know them. So Lois, Timothy's grandmother, understood this and made wise investments in her children. Amazing, isn't it? Let's look at the first mention of Lois's grandson and see what the Bible has to say about him. Acts 16, 1-3. Then he came to Derbe and Lystra, and behold, a certain disciple was there named Timotheus, the son of a certain woman, which was a Jewess and believed, but his father was a Shubon in it. But, that was the crippling factor in it, But it goes on to say, which in verse 2, which was well reported of by the brethren that were at Lystra and Iconium, him would Paul because of the Jews which were in those quarters, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. So despite that crippled nature, despite the fact that he came from the root of an unbeliever, an unbelieving father, Timothy was a product of a mixed marriage between a believing Jew and a Greek Gentile. And not much is said about Timothy's father. We are told that Timothy's father was a Gentile. He was an unbeliever. Most don't think that Timothy's father was a believer. Do you know why? Because Timothy was not circumcised. And if you were a believer, he was Greek. So it should be assumed that either Timothy's father remained unconverted, or by this time he had died. Well, sometimes when I hear people give excuses, my father took my name, my father used me for this. You know what the Greeks used to do? There is no God that the Greeks didn't have. But notice what the Bible says about Timothy's character. He was well reported of by the brethren. Timothy had an incredible testimony among the believers in Lystra and in Iconium. He had a reputation that was above reproach with the brethren. In short, Mama and Grandmama did an excellent job. That is the only way I can describe Timothy. That his mother and his grandmother were fantastic women. Excellent. Excellent women. Proverbs 31 women. Those two men were excellent. What a legacy to have. What a legacy. And I pray that all the time. I've said, you know, when I took this calling, what the Holy Spirit said to me, he said, if you can do this calling excellently for 10 generations, they will say there was a woman called Kemi. Excellent. Excellent. Lois, godly values and attitudes found in the Word of God in the life of Timothy. We can see God's work in his life. We can see God was working in and through the life of Timothy. And Paul saw Timothy and took him under his wings and adopted him spiritually. He was the son that Paul never had. And Paul was that father that Timothy didn't have. And we see what we call unashamed adoption. It was as if Paul picked up where grandma and mama left off. As mama and grandmother, he needed still some level of parenting, mentorship, and Paul took over. We see the Apostle Paul investing his life into the life of Timothy. They had an incredible relationship, Paul and Timothy, incredible. And I pray that for all men, that you will find somebody that will pour their all into you. Build them up. And they also will do the same for the next generation and the next to come. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 4:14 to 17. I write not these things, though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have ye not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. Wherefore I beseech you, be ye followers of me. For this cause I have sent unto you Timotheus, who is my beloved son, and faithful in the Lord, who shall bring you into remembrance of my ways which be in Christ, as I teach everywhere in every church. Everybody needs a mentor. It's Paul talking about Timothy to my members of my ministry. I say, all you need to do, go to a church. See the way the women dress. Go and look at the pastor's wife. You'll find they all dress the same way. If truly they are under the, if they are following her mentorship. It's so simple. Try, go and look in different churches. Paul referred to Timothy as his beloved son. He was unashamed in letting everyone know that this incredible young man, this man with a fantastic reputation, who was above reproach, was spiritually his son. Paul had no physiological connection with Timothy, but spiritually he became the type of father that Timothy never had. Again, we see how God can use relationships, physical, that is his mother and his grandmother, and spiritual in the lives of those who will still seek him. But you have to look for God. I didn't say look for man, look for God. God will send you what you need. God will send you what you need. You know, you just need somebody that's going to say to you, just do it this way. Just do it this way. Look for God and let God do what he has to do in your life. And this is such an incredible testimony of how the power of God can impact the life of somebody. You see, Timothy was not just an awesome child. He was not only obedient. He was not only respectable. But of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is for me the most important. Philippians 2:19 to 23 says, but I trust in the Lord Jesus who sent Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ's. But ye know the proof of him, that as a son with the Father, he hath served with me in the gospel. Him therefore I hope to send presently so that I shall see how it will go with me. Ah, what a testimony. What a testament about somebody. For anybody who thinks like me, Timothy is me. If I send Timothy to you, I am going myself. That is the meaning. There is nobody that thinks exactly like I do when it comes to ministry, except this guy, my beloved son in the faith. Not only does he think like me, Timothy acts like me. Is there anyone you can say that about yourself that is just like you? He says, Timothy will naturally care for your state. Because that is what Paul did. And I ask you this evening, where do you think Timothy developed his incredible love for others? Who do you think modeled and displayed this for Timothy? The Bible tells us that the two biggest influences in Timothy's life. And of course, we know the third influence came from perhaps the most incredible missionary to ever live. So is it a wonder that Timothy was the kind of person he was, that he was such a tender, caring kind of guy? Caring for others came natural to Timothy. So I ask you this evening, does it come natural to you? Does it? Having to drop everything for others, does it come naturally to you? You know, everything we believe as Christians, I tell you this, and sometimes for those who are close to me, sometimes some people say SL is very hard. But you know, heat to boil an egg. But when you boil it to the right temperature and for the right amount of time, you will get to that soft yolk inside it. Everything that God desires for us boils down to the last point, 36 to 40. Master, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So, do we love God the way we ought to love God? Will we love other people the way he wants us, he desires us to love them? You see, if you do, perhaps you will end up with a legacy, much like Lois. A legacy of people that we have invested the word of God into. People who have an unfeigned faith. People who are loving and caring for others. Because you know something? That is what ministry is all about. I was talking to one of my daughters this evening and I said, you know, ministry is just so much more about than praying. So much more than just praying. There's just so much that we have to do. So much needs still to be done in ministry. This afternoon, you know, I've had a number of people call me and they say, what are you doing today, SL? And I'm like, I'm just working. I'm just trying to finish all our ministrations and different programs and projects that are coming up. Because there's still so much that we need to do. This is what God desires from us. And it is worded this way in Timothy, 1 Timothy 1:5. Now the end of the commandment is charity, out of a pure heart and a good conscience and of faith unfeigned. So we see it once again. Unconditional care, that is charity, good conscience, unashamed, and unfeigned faith. What an incredible example that Lois set for her grandson and her daughter. What an incredible impact a mother can have. And let's remember this as we prepare to celebrate Mothering Sunday at the end of this week. Make this confession. I positively influence all those that come in contact with me for Christ. I positively influence them. Everyone who comes in contact with me I influence them positively for Christ. I positively influence all those who come in contact with me for Christ. The Bible tells us, Matthew 5:13-16, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its flavor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out, to be trodden under foot of men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bowl. It gives light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Let's just thank God this evening for the power of influence that he has given to each and every one of us, because he has given us power of influence. Let's ask God, Father, want to use you for good and not evil. Father, help us to make the most use of the opportunities you give to us, the most use of the opportunities that you have put before us. For you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank for your goodness, your mercy. Thank you for sending Jesus to be the perfect example to us, for us. We are thankful that that same power that raised Christ from the dead is available for us right now. It lives in us. Let's ask God to strengthen us in the spirit. Let's thank God for the Holy Spirit that walks, that lives in us, that we will walk worthy of the calling that we have been given. Let's pray that any influence that we have will be for good, not for evil, and will be for His glory alone. And let's thank God for every godly example that we have in our lives. Let's thank God for godly mothers. Let's thank God for godly mothers. Let's thank God because motherhood is a calling. And let's thank God for the gift. Amen. Our Father and our God, we thank you for the marvelous things you have taught us this evening. Father, thank you for the life of Lois, for the life of Eunice, for the life of Timothy, and of course for the life of Paul. Father, I want to thank you for all mothers, mothers-to-be, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you for your love you've revealed to us this evening, and for the love that we have shared as a body. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Beloved, if you've enjoyed this ministration, which I know you have, you want to find out more about our ministry, kindly visit www.this on YouTube. And it's still looking at motherhood, looking at Mothering Sunday. And it's called Do What You Do. God bless you. I look forward to as many of you that will also participate in Bible study this evening. And of course, tomorrow morning, the 5 a.m. declarations. God bless you. I love you with the love of the Lord. Stay lifted. Have a fantastic evening.